Alright, so we're recording. And last thing is lecture. Alright, any questions before we start?
I have one.
Sure.
What's the CP command for instead of copying over, to just copy to the end or after the end?
Oh, so you could use cat. You could say cat, new file, and then two greater than signs, old file. And this means append. So that would read the contents of this file and add it to the end of that file. An SCP switch. I mean, SCP is probably the same thing as CP. But I don't see that. Good question. I've never thought of trying that. It's an interesting question.
The reason I ask is because, you know, for the not having to enter a password on the server thing,
mm-hmm.
Copy over your hard key, and I copied it over from two different computers, and I was like, okay, what the heck? Didn't I copy this over? But I overwrote it, so only one of them worked.
Oh, so you want to add it to the end of the SSH file?
Authorized keys.
Oh, the authorized keys. Can you just log into the server and just, you know, copy it over to something different and then log into the server and just add it to the end yourself?
I could.
That's probably your best bet.
Okay. I was just wondering if there's anything built into CP that would allow me to do
something. I didn't see a switch or a mention in SCP. But I mean, you can do SSH with general commands. And put whatever command you want in there. That's compression. There's a way to put a command at the end of SSH. Actually, I think that's the default. So if you SSH, username at Linux, etc., and then type in a command, instead of trying to log you in, it'll execute that command as yourself on that machine. And so you might be able to do that. Or, you know, you could SCP it as you know, key 2, and then do an SSH command to append key 2 to your authorized keys file.
So what does SCP mean?
So SCP is a secure version of CP, and it works from machine to machine. So you can secure copy from one machine colon file to another machine colon file, and it'll copy it across the network. And that can be useful. Now you can do this with, you know, SFTP, or you can do it with WinSCP or things like that, but SCP is a nice way to combine all of that. The other command along those lines that I strongly recommend if you're doing this kind of thing is rsync. Because rsync will copy, you know, files, directories, entire file systems from one machine to another, but it does it in a smart way. It will fingerprint the files, it will look at timestamps, and it will only copy the stuff that actually needs to be copied according to whatever criteria you specify. So this is the go-to backup tool on Linux systems. So you know, I have an external machine, it's a Raspberry Pi, and every few hours something basically rsyncs all of my files over to a remote system and gives me a rolling backup. So this is a really powerful tool, super fast. Good one to know.
Getting into pseudo-rs files.
Yeah, that too.
Not the servers though.
Yeah, so if permissions are set correctly, then you can't do that. So like my, go ahead.
I said it's pretty good because you can have permissions and still rsync to a file even if you don't have permissions to it. There's other like specific stuff you have to do to block it.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, it depends who you're logging in as also. So my timestamp program that I run, you know, during lecture, and you know, I can type a message and it shows up on the screen, and it also creates a timestamp that that gets loaded into YouTube. So that uses SCP to take the list of timestamps that have been created and copy it over to this running file that you can get to through the website. So that's you know, an example use. Of course, I just killed my timestamp program, but oh well. Alright, let's see. Got any changes from anything I heard, read another SCP acronym. A lot during spooky time. Interesting. Yeah, acronyms are always like ambiguous. All right, let's look at the ODP.
And let me bring this intensity down a bit. You're allowing us to choose group features for PA4.
PA4, you can choose your own groups, yes. And if you really don't want to work in a group, you can work alone. But it's a nice project to work with others on because it sort of breaks out nicely into a set of pieces. And it's a way to practice, you know, if you want to practice using Git to share a repository, if you want to... you know, practice communication skills with who's doing what and how to coordinate and how to meet and so on. Those are things that you'll be required to do, you know, in university classes. And, you know, in most cases, a large part of your grade will depend on these kinds of collaborations. So this is a chance to sort of do a lower cost of entry practice on that.
I totally do agree.
Yeah, so the online part can be more or less challenging, I guess. Everybody's kind of used to doing things online now through Zoom or whatever, and so that's kind of useful. But, you know, it's harder to collaborate sometimes like that. All right, so ODP461, you are creating a function named trim. It takes one argument, which is an array of characters. It does not return anything, right? As usual, it does not print anything either. It takes an argument and it modifies it. The way it modifies it, it just removes the last character, assuming that there is a character in this string. If the string is empty, don't do anything to it, right? Just return it back. And you can use string length and string copy if you like, but don't use any other built-in string functions. And so, for example, if you want to test your program, you could do something like this. Make a character array with some stuff, some space in it. Copy a string like hello into it. Call your trim function. Print out that string after you come back from trim, and it should be, in this case, H-E-L-L. And so if you did a test like this, some samples of what you would expect. If you say happy, you should get back hap. If you say okay, you should get OKA. If you put in a string with a single character, you should get back an empty string. If you put in a string that's empty to begin with, you should still get back an empty string. And doing this is, you know, like so many things in this business, it's easy to do in theory, but there are always details. So if you have... an incoming argument like str, declare it as a car start. Don't declare it as like character 120, because you don't know if it's 120 characters. It could be a million characters. But it's a car star. named STR in this case. And really, all you need to do is, you know, find the length of the string. So string length will do that. And if our string is happy, the index of each of these characters looks like this. And the string length will return 5. It's the number of characters, not including the null terminator, and that's important. So string length on this string would be 5, H-A-P-P-Y. To get rid of the last character, we need to know its index. Well, in this case, the last character, its index is 4. So the index is always going to be the string length minus 1. Right, so index equals length minus 1. And then to get rid of this character, all we have to do is change it to a null terminator. So if we said string bracket index equals null terminator, that basically truncates the string by one character. It changes this to be a backslash 0. And now our string is just 4 characters, H-A-P-P, and the null terminator says that's all. And then the only thing you have to worry about is the length of the string 0. And if it is, right, if your string looks like this, string length equals 0, this would say, you know, I want to change the character at index minus 1. Don't do that, right? That's likely to seg fault, or at least change something you didn't want to change. So you need to throw an extra check in here to see if the string is length 0, and if it is, just return. You don't have to do anything. Otherwise, just take the last character in the string, which you can find from string length minus 1, set it to a null terminator. All right, questions about that?
String index equals, is that that's a bunch of like little marks. Could you maybe refine that? Is it just a...
This?
Yes.
It's a null terminator, so single quote backslash 0.
Cool.
This is a mix of C and pseudocode. But, you know, if you have a string like A, B, C, D, E, it's always got a null terminator on the end. If I were to change this to a null terminator, my string basically changes to just A, B. Because anything I do, printf, string length, string compare, etc., when I look at this as a string, it's going to see the A, it's going to see the B, it's going to see this null terminator. That's as far as it's going to look. And it's going to say this is a string containing two characters, A and B. And the fact that there's, you know, a D and an E and another null terminator sitting here makes no difference. None of the programs that think about strings are going to look beyond that null terminator. So we can truncate, basically, by just moving that backslash 0 wherever we want in the string.
So if string length is 0, what do you want to return? Empty string, null, undefined?
Well, you never return anything because the function is void. So you can just say return, and you don't make any change to the string.
Okay, so just return colon.
Just return, yeah.
Return
semicolon. I tried to make some test cases that would seg fault if you didn't do that right, and I couldn't come up with one, so I think even if you don't handle that right, it's going to give you 10 points, but do it right anyway. All right, and I want to mention one other thing in here. So, test your program thoroughly using code such as this. And you really want to use code like this when you do your tests. And let me show you why. So let's just write some test code. Let me do what we did in the example. A, B, C, D, E. And we said if you change this character right here to a null terminator, the string would get truncated to be just A, B. So the index of this character, this is index 0, 1. This is character 2 in our string. So let's do this. Print F.
Is that backslash 0 or backslash O?
That's always a 0.
Oh, yeah.
Just clarifying.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm just saying that it's not a dumb question. If it's just a clarifying question.
Oh no, it's definitely a good question. Yeah, so backslashes in C, there's a few backslashes that are understood. Backslash 0 is ASCII code 0. Backslash R is a return, that's ASCII code 13. Backslash N that we use all the time is an ASCII code 10. Backslash T, I think, is a tab, that's an ASCII code 8. And there may be a backslash E for an escape, but I don't know. But this is basically a way to say, hey, the next character is something different, right? I don't want to actually print a backslash followed by an R. The backslash is what we think of as an escape character. And the thing that follows it specifies some other thing than what it looks like. So this is not the letter R. This is together a way to say I want what we call a carriage return, ASCII code 13. And this little thing right here, this thing changed my life. Like, a number of decades ago, that really launched like all the research I've done ever since I was in graduate school. That little backslash is huge. And I could do like, you know, a 3-hour lecture right now just talking about that backslash. I won't subject you to that. But this notion of being able to take this and say, is this the letter R or is it a way to represent something else? Right, that distinction is made by this one character, and this one character is sort of the thing that makes a particular computer architecture called a cell matrix work. So yeah, there's a lot of good stuff in here. But yeah, short answer, that's a 0, not an O.
Is there a section of the man pages that would give a list of escape characters?
Well, so they're escape characters by convention, right? So the compiler understands them. I'm thinking maybe the manual page for printf might do some of these. I don't know if this is a complete list for what the C compiler would understand, but here's definitely a few of them that we can use, at least in some context. So there is an escape. New line, carriage return tab, but there's a bunch that I missed apparently. Backspace is always good. And backslash followed by 1 to 3 digits is a general way of describing a character using its ASCII code in octal. So backslash 0 is really saying, you know, ASCII character 0, which is null. But I guess we could do backslash, you know, 001, get ASCII code 1, and so on. Plus you can do unicodes, right, with different numbers of bytes and... so that's all good. So yeah, look at the man page for printf. So let's try this. Let's take character 2 and change it to a backslash 0. And then let's print out the new value of the string. And I forgot some stuff.
Your your function decoration for that string function throws a warning.
For my string function?
For the trim.
Oh. What's the warning?
A void, and then it returns the char.
It shouldn't return a char. It shouldn't return anything. So your trim function does not return a value. You can just say return to exit. But it accepts an argument, which is a char star. And that argument is the thing that you make the change to.
So if it doesn't return a value, it makes a change to a string.
Well, let's do a function with this.
Because it's a void, it's changing the value you pass it.
Mm-hmm.
It's an out parameter.
It's an out parameter.
Oh, okay. Well, I returned it. It still works. So.
So, this is worth going over anyway, because passing pointers is kind of weird sometimes. So let's make this void new, and let's just pass in something called str, and let's just do something really dangerous. Let's just set element 2 to the null terminator. Now that's not what you want to do in your trim function, obviously. You want to find the length and set the last character to be null. But let's just do this for practice in passing to a function. So temp is my string. I'm going to set it equal to ABCDE. I'm going to print it out initially. I'm going to print it inside angle brackets so we can see if there's anything extra at the end of it. And then I'm going to pass it to this function new. And then I'm going to print the new value of temp. And this function will change the argument, right? The argument is str. That's the thing I'm modifying in here. So I don't have to return anything. I can say return if I want. But the output of the function is basically in the thing that you pass to it. So if I do that and I run try 0, right, initial string is ABCDE, new string is AB. So that's what we were hoping would happen. But here's what you want to avoid. If you try to do it like this, set temp to be ABCDE, print it out, call your function, then print out the new string. Alright, that's going to seg fault. And the reason that's going to seg fault is because when you declare a string like this, you're putting it in a memory area that can't be modified. So you're putting this in read-only memory, and then down here I'm trying to modify something in that read-only location, and that generates a seg fault. So for this particular ODP, right, we can't get away with just doing this to declare a string, because we want to modify the string. So that's why I suggest in the README to make yourself an array, and then use string copy to copy whatever string you want to work with into that array. When you declare an array like this, it can be read, it can also be written. So that'll save you from mysterious seg faults. All right, questions on that? Let's see, I thought start temp makes a string with a certain amount of length depending on what the user typed. Yes, so when you say char star temp, this sets up at least 6 bytes in memory, and then it copies into those bytes A, B, C, D, E, followed by an null terminator. I don't know if you can do something like char temp bracket 6 equals. It may let you do that. There may be a different way you need to initialize it. But yeah, this will correctly initialize the string, which you can see when you print it out. It just makes it non-modifiable. I don't feel like it's gonna let us do this. Hey, it does. Well, that's weird. Does it have to match the exact length? Cool. Alright, I learned something new. Woo. Yeah, so you can do that too. C is magic. Alright, so other questions about that? So let's talk about PA4, because I want to make sure we get started on this, because I'm giving you a chunk of time to do this, but it can take a chunk of time. If you're working in a group, that's probably not as efficient as working alone. It may take less time because you can divide problems out, but efficiency-wise, there's usually a loss when you try to parallelize. So as tempting as it might be to say, you know, well, I'm going to work on physics and calc for the next week, and I'll look at this next Wednesday, right? Don't do that, right? Try to get started on this sooner rather than later. Because it can take a long time, but you have a lot of freedom in what you're going to do for PA4. So you can kind of, you know, decide how complex you want to get. All right, so programming assignment 4. So you're going to make an appointment calendar. Something that basically lets you record, you know, an appointment with a given date and say, you know, on Tuesday I've got to take my dog to the groomer. And will let you look at appointments that are upcoming. May let you modify appointments or delete appointments or things like that. And it's going to be a graphical program. It's going to be written in Bash, so it'll be a shell script. It's going to be GUI based, so you have things popping up and you can point and click with the mouse and so on and so forth. And it's going to be a group project, if you like, in groups of up to 4 people. Alright, and I'm going to put a few requirements on this, most of which I've already said, and then you're going to have creative freedom to do pretty much whatever else you want. Right, which I think makes this a more fun project than some of the other ones, which have been, you know, really painfully specific about, you know, you must have exactly 2 arguments, and if you have an X after an integer, you must throw an error, and that kind of stuff. So this one, we're kind of like opening it up, and you're going to have, you know, the freedom to sort of make what you think are appropriate decisions on the design and implementation of this. All right, so essential requirements. It's got to run on the Linux server. It's got to use the dialog command to create a GUI, and you need to be able to do at least 3 things in your calendar program. Make an appointment on a given date, delete an appointment that you've already made, and get a list of all future appointments. And how you do this is pretty much entirely up to you. We're going to talk about the dialog command, which will give you a way to create, you know, a box that displays information or that people can type things into, or will display a calendar and let people choose a date and so on and so forth. And then using that as, you know, one of your tools, you're going to design this application. You're going to come up with, you know, how you're going to put this in a script and then actually create the code for it. This should work primarily from the graphical interfaces. You should not have to go into the command line to, you know, type information in or respond to questions or, you know, type in the description of your appointment or things like that. Everything should be done through the GUIs. It should also remember your appointments after you exit your program. So you're going to want to use a file probably to save appointment information. You can design that however you like, but one suggestion is, you know, just use plain text. Make a file with, like, you know, a date, a time, and a description of the appointment, maybe separated by pipes. And so each appointment corresponds to one row of this file. And if you open this file up from a Bash script, it's pretty easy to ingest. You can break it apart using awk, for example, which we'll talk about. And then you can write things into that file. Oh, cool. Awesome. All right, so since you're going to be collaborating, you may want to have a shared area where you can store your calendar information. You can put that under one of your directories, but you can also, if you want, create a directory under /temp/calendar. So this is a writable area, and if you want to claim a directory in there, go ahead and make a directory with, you know, your group name or whatever you want, and you can put your shared files in there as far as, you know, storing the calendar, or if you're going to make backups of the calendar or things like that. Don't put your code in a shared area, though, on the server, because then other people can read your code. But, you know, figure out how to share it through Git or something like this. You can do this as a solo program if you like. I recommend working in groups just because the group experience is important to get, and particularly if you're not very comfortable with working in groups, this is probably a good way to get into that. Because it's you know, it's just one assignment out of five. It's not going to break your grade what you do on this, but, you know, up to you. Additional features. So you need to implement three additional features. And here's a list of possible additional features you could implement. So ability to edit an appointment after it's been made. Go in and change the description or change the date or something like that. Ability to add a time as well as a date to the appointment. Ability to add an ending time as well as a start time so that you could say this appointment goes from 2 to 4 on this date. Managing a conflict, conflicts between appointments. You're not required to do that by default. So I can schedule 5 things on Monday, right? But if I want to manage conflicts either on date or on time, you can do that. You're required to be able to look at all future appointments, but you could say, show me all the appointments on a given date or between two dates. Add a reminder feature, which might tell you, you know, look at today's date, and in the beginning of your program, say, here's what you have due today, right? Adding an alarm feature that can, you know, alert you if, you know, it's 5 minutes from an appointment or something. Being able to import or export with other utilities like Google Calendar. That's a fairly ambitious one. But three additional features, right? Here's some that you can choose from. If you come up with other ideas for additional features, let me know, and I'll give you a thumbs up or thumbs down, right? It doesn't have to just be these. So let yourself be creative, and let yourself have fun with this, right? So you can work in groups of up to 4 people. Here's how I want you to tell me if you have a group. Send me email to my regular nmacias@clark.edu account. Make the subject CSE224PA4 group, and in the body of the message, list the full Canvas name of all the people in your group, including yourself. Okay? The cleaner that you make this, the less likely there's going to be confusion when it comes to groups and grades and things like that. Right? So if you know who you're going to work with, send me one email, put that in the subject, and then in the body, just list the names of each of the people in the group using the full Canvas names. And I'll record that, and I'll use that to you know, grade your submissions. And you have until a week from yesterday, so November 10th, to do that. Hold on, I have a screaming tea kettle.
Got it.
Oh, you got
Sorry,
it?
Yeah.
No problem. Tea kettles work, man. I'm so glad they're not made by Microsoft, because it would be like asking for an update while it's like burning. All right, if I don't get an email from you by the 10th, I'll assume you're working alone. So if you're going to work alone, you don't have to send me an email. You can if you want to you know, document that. But if I don't get a note from you, I'll assume you're working by yourself, which is fine. And then submission, this should say November, not now. Project is due 8 a.m. Monday, November 15th. So this is a rare Monday due date, right? Reason being, it's a group project. You might, you know, need the weekend to pin down some last details and so on. So this is due on Monday instead of Friday, November 15th. And I'm going to ask that you know, you can share this with each other through Git however you want, but the final upload for the project should be in a subdirectory named PA4Final. I'm going to ask that only one person from your group create this subdirectory in your CSE224. Obviously, you can make subdirectories with whatever names you want, right? But when I download the repositories on that Monday morning, right, if there's an entry from someone in this directory, right, I'm going to start grading that. And so you want to coordinate among your group members, figure out who's going to do the submission, basically. And then you get to demonstrate these to the class, because, you know, one person's program is going to look totally different from another group's programs, and I don't necessarily know how to use it, and I'm not going to require you to make documentation. So you're going to demonstrate your program to the class, and we'll start demonstrations that morning that they're due, which is November 15th. So what will happen is Wednesday, after I've got the list of who's working with who, I'll go ahead and I'll make a randomized order of presentations, and we'll just go in that order, and each person or a group will present their project. This is a super duper low key presentation, right? You don't have to dress up for it. You don't have to, you know, rehearse your speeches or anything like that. It's really just, you know, go through your program, show what it does. And basically what I'd like to see is I'd like to see you, you know, add some appointments to your calendar, show that you can see what those appointments are, add some new appointments, show all the appointments in the future, exit the program, go back in, see that the appointments are still there, and then demonstrate whatever additional features you added. I recommend rehearsing your presentation only in terms of, you know, who's going to do what. Is one person going to do all of this, or is you know, this person going to do these features and this other person do those other features and so on. Just figure that out amongst yourselves, right? But you know, you're not graded on the polish of your presentation or how many jokes you tell or things like that. It's just easier for you to demonstrate what your program does than for me to try to figure out how to use it. All right, and then grading is super straightforward, right? So the first thing is to receive any points. The program has to be submitted by the deadline, has to run on the server, it must use the dialog command, and it must be presented in class. All right, that's to get any points for it. And then the grading is just straight out of the requirements. If you can make an appointment on a given date, that's 20 points. If you can delete, it's 20. If you can see all the upcoming, that's 20. So 60 points for those three minimum requirements. If you save the calendar from run to run, that's 10 points. And then three additional features, 10 points each. And last comment here is just like start early and try to have fun with this. Right, it's a lot of freedom in what you do and how you do it, and to me those are always the most fun assignments. Right, when you're at a company and you know you're feeling like a cog in the machine maybe some days, right? It's gonna be making the donuts. You're gonna go in and it's like, oh yeah, I have to write the such and such function, and you're just gonna sit there and do that, and you're gonna have, you know, all these specifications on how you do it and so on. So this is the fun part of programming, right? It's like, I'm gonna have this thing, you know, do such and such, and it's going to, you know, do whatever. So have fun with that.
I have a question.
Yeah.
You said one of the features or the possible features to be added is the alarm function. How would that alarm
So there's
check that like while you're logged into the server, is something that would pop up.
So there's a utility called cron that will let you say, you know, do something at a certain scheduled time, for example every 5 minutes run this program. And what this program could do is check to see if there's an appointment that is, you know, now due. Something that wasn't due 5 minutes ago, but is now, you know, past due. And if it is, you could have it, you know, send you an email, for example, and say, hey, you know, time to go to the dentist or whatever.
Okay.
That would be one way to do it. If you... That's a little tricky. So on the Linux machine, you can send mail with the mail command.
Can you send it to anything? Like, could I send it to my regular email?
I don't think it will do outgoing.
Whatever the mail command can do,
think this will bounce. Yeah. So I don't have outgoing mail set up, but you can send it to yourself. Yeah, that would be fun, right? So there's my message. Yeah, so don't send it to me. But yeah, you can send it to yourself. Totally. Or there might be other things you could do. I'm not sure what. You could get arbitrarily creative. You could create a file in your home directory, and you could set your bash RC so that when you log in, it looks for that file and tells you all the things that are happening right now. That would be one option. You can also use the write command to send a message. You can say write username, and you'll get a message saying, hey, here comes a message. So you could do that.
Wait, you can do that? How do you do?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Do they get it? Do they just get it upon login?
No, you have to be logged in. If you try to write to somebody who's not logged in, it'll say they're not logged in. But, you know, if you're sitting on your terminal typing, you could all of a sudden get a message saying, like, hey, time to have some food. And if somebody starts spamming you with that, you can use the message command to turn that off. So you can say MESGN, and it'll disable people from writing to you. But I'll leave mine on. Alright, so that's PA4. And let me at least get started on the dialogue command. And dialogue is built into the Linux server. You can install it if it's not installed by default on your own machine. And it does a GUI, but it's like a 1980s style GUI, so you don't need to have, you know, the ability to actually control the user's display. It's all just done through plain text. So dialogue, really easy version of this. So dialogue --infobox. This is a test 00, and it just pops up a little info box that says this is a test, and it's the nice blue background. It's got the drop shadow and all of that, and that's all it does. So if I did that in a script, right, when I got to that part of my script, this is what I would see. And so we'll spend a good part of tomorrow going through specific commands. But for example, message box pops up a message box and waits for you to say okay. And I can click on this, or I can just hit enter, or I can hit a space bar, and any of those things, you know, qualify as the same as a mouse click. And all of these things have the option to specify titles and other options. So I can say --title. Title important stuff. And so, you know, I've got a little header on here. And you can put these together with other things. So dialogue. Let's make an info box, and what I'm going to put in there is the result of a command, because I'm putting this inside back quotes. So I'm going to do cow say hello. Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
00, and so there's a info box with a talking cow. So now we've got, you know, all the pieces we need to do anything important. And so we can display information a variety of ways. We can interact with the user. So one simple way to do an interaction is the yes-no box. So if I just say --yes-no and I put in a message, it will ask me, you know, yes or no. And I can use my arrow keys to switch between these. I can use my tab keys to switch between these, or I can just click on one of these. And this sets that $?? Status variable. So I said no, $?? Is 1. If I say yes, $?? Will be 0. So I can put up a basic yes-no dialogue, ask the user to respond, and figure out what they clicked. $?? Is the result of your previous bash command. So the dialogue command will exit, in this case, with a 1 or a 0. If I type something weird, $?? Will be non-zero, usually if there's an error. If I look at it again, it's a 0 because this command succeeded, and so the status of that command is a 0. So it always shows the previous command's exit status. And there's a bunch of things you can do. And we'll go through these more carefully tomorrow, but you know, I can make a drop-down list that lets me choose, you know, one of three items, and it will output whatever the choice was. And so we'll talk about how we can capture the output if you do something like this. How can we see what item the person selected? We can also do calendars, which will be really useful for this assignment. So I can do calendar, I can put a title, I can put in a default date, right, day, month, and year, and there's a calendar. And, you know, I can click on the 25th and say OK, and there's a way I can capture that from Bash. So there's manual pages on this. And it's probably most fun to just play around with. You can use those examples I just gave you to kind of get started, but you know, there's all these different types of dialogues we can create, and they all have different options that more or less work across the different dialogues. So you can mess around with that. We'll play around with it more tomorrow. We'll go through some more details, and that should get you started. All right. That's all I got. Have a good afternoon. I will see you tomorrow.